Greetings. In part one of this series, I introduced the definition of delusion. Delusion is not the false thing that is believed. It is the state or condition of believing the false information. It is important to distinguish between delusion and simple errors or disagreements. Some ideas are believed because sufficient understanding has simply not been obtained. A person can believe something that is incorrect simply because they have never heard that which is correct. However, some have chosen to ignore the specific information that would modify or threaten their dogma. My hope is to attempt to take a C.S. Lewis-esque approach and not get into individual issues that are divisive. The hard thing is this: some disagreements, doctrinal and otherwise, arise because of subjective misunderstandings. In fact, there is an old expression I sometimes correct myself with: do not ascribe malice where simple ignorance or stupidity is a sufficient explanation. I have no doubt that some who disagree with me may consider me the stupid or ignorant person in the disagreement. The point is to not judge harshly on an assumption of evil intent. But in the future, many may commit gross acts of evil and think they do it for benevolent reasons. John 16:2, they will ban you from the synagogues. In fact, a time is coming when anyone who kills you will think he is offering service to God or Allah. Think how strong that delusion is, that one can commit murder for the wrong idea, and think it is a holy act. Moving on, there was a point I raised in video 1. Paul is about to discuss two topics, the coming of the Lord and two, our gathering together to him. That's from 2 Thessalonians 2:1. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. In the rest of the video, I did not point out where case 2 was discussed. That jumped out at me during production and editing. So where does Paul address point 2, the gathering together to him? Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. When the Lord gathers us together, will he not be relocating us? Think about those words. As a verb, gathering implies an action, moving. If you are a student about to leave one class for another, you gather your things. You pick them up to carry them, to take them with you. Our gathering together to him. Notice our gathering together to him. To is a preposition expressing motion in a direction. John 14:3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I will come again and receive you unto myself. So our gathering together to him. I will come again and receive you unto myself. Maybe your mind also recalled the following. Mark 13:27, and he will send out the angels to gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. So did mine. And this is where the video takes a turn. To conflate or not to conflate? That is the question. Mark 13:27 is part of the Olivet Discourse or Olivet Prophecy. Mark 13:27 comes after the following passage. Mark 13:24, however, after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. So Mark 13:27 refers to after the tribulation. Let's lay out a timeline. Paul, in Thessalonians, says the following: "For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work in the world, but it is restrained only until he who restrains is taken out of the way, and then the lawless one, the Antichrist, will be revealed, and the Lord Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth and bring him to an end by his appearing at his," meaning Jesus's, "coming." There are two events given a definite sequence. Restrained only until he who restrains is taken out of the way. The one who restrains is taken out of the way, removed. And then the lawless one, the Antichrist, will be revealed. Then the Antichrist will be revealed, after the restrainer has been removed. The sequence in this passage is clearly ordered that way. The Antichrist comes after the removal of the restrainer. Let's contrast that with Mark and the Olivet Discourse. Mark 13:24, "However, after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out the angels to gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven." To make this easier to grasp, we've just seen several details in four verses. Mark 13:24, "After the tribulation, sun and moon dark." Verse 25, "Stars fall, powers shaken." Verse 26, "Sign of the Son of Man coming in the clouds." Verse 27, "He sends angels to gather the elect." In this sequence, the elect are gathered after the tribulation. There will also be astronomical events which cannot be overlooked before the gathering. So 2 Thessalonians 2 and Mark 13. In verse 7, the restrainer is removed. In verse 8, the Antichrist is revealed. And then we have the period called the tribulation. In Mark 13, the tribulation finishes. So that means the tribulation came before verse 24. And then the angels gather the elect. If one is simply looking for an accusation against the Bible, one could claim this was inconsistent and contradictory. But that is based on an implied assumption there is only one event being described. But what if one were able to consider the possibility of two separate events? Remember, Paul introduced talking about two things. One, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and two, our gathering together to him. I can certainly understand how those appear similar to Mark 13, verses 24 and 27. Now, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you, brothers, and in Mark 13, "At that time they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and he will send out the angels to gather his elect from the four winds." Clearly, both of these deal with the, or a, coming in the future. But riddle me this: why does the one in Mark call him the Son of Man, while the other calls him the Lord Jesus Christ? I can neither prove nor refute this is a significant difference. But my heart is telling me there is something implied there. Let's leave that as unproven, one way or the other, for the moment, and consider the broader context. If 2 Thessalonians 2:13 is absolutely linked to Mark 13, the Bible is confused in the detailed description of the sequence of events. The gathering of the elect, assumed to be the Christian church, happens after the tribulation, after the Antichrist is known and revealed. We must recognize that we are assuming the reference to the elect means the Christian, Gentile, church, and not Jewish saints or the 144,000 or some other group. But someone or something is removed before the tribulation. At least we assume the Antichrist is revealed at the start of the tribulation. But what if someone or something is removed to start the tribulation? What if the tribulation starts when the restrainer is removed and the Antichrist is revealed later, either immediately or perhaps midway? Consider for a moment, what does revealed even mean in this context? And then the lawless one, the Antichrist, will be revealed. Revealed as in manifest, or revealed as in known and comprehended? I'm not intending to ramble, but in the context of strong delusion, the, a, or otherwise, will those under strong delusion be able to comprehend the Antichrist is the Antichrist foretold by the Bible? Think about it. Those under strong delusion will be robbed by God of the ability to discern truth, so that they believe a lie. If the Muslim Mahdi, who is the Antichrist, claims to kill someone who the Mahdi declares is the Antichrist, will anyone present comprehend it is the Antichrist doing the killing and telling a lie? I can only speculate someone not under strong delusion might be capable of such discernment. But there are several scenarios to consider. If the Holy Spirit is the restrainer who is removed, do Christians left behind retain the ability to perceive all truth? John 14:26, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." And yes, I am assuming all things means all truthful things. If the Christian church is the restrainer who is removed, and the Holy Spirit remains, there can be tribulation saints who are not condemned by strong delusion. Those tribulation saints could have the big, aha, moment of realization who the Antichrist is. The Antichrist might be revealed to those not under strong delusion, who are incapable from discerning the truth that the Antichrist is even real, and so might receive the Bible's message of salvation. Again, I apologize for seeming to ramble, but considering the scenarios, the most likely scenario to me is of the pre-tribulation rapture. And that rapture removes the church, or a part of it, but leaves the Holy Spirit in the earth. Now, how dare I imply that only part of the church be raptured? That is a great question. And I do not say I have any direct word from God, as in, "Thus saith the Lord." I really have to go back to the words of Jesus the Messiah himself. Luke 21:36, "Watch you therefore, and pray always, that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man." The King James Version uses "accounted worthy," but the Greek word implies power, prevail, strength. That is a topic worthy of a whole video by itself, the qualification. For the moment, I will limit reference to this scripture to participation. Watch you therefore, and pray always, that you may. Jesus implies participation depends upon something you voluntarily do. Therefore, watch and pray, that you may participate in the escape. If you do not believe in the rapture, I would respectfully love to hear your best explanation of the meaning of this command from Jesus. The command is watch always and pray always. It is the reason to watch and pray that I have never heard adequately explained by mid, post, or non-rapture believers. What do you think you are to escape if the tribulation is done and the Son of Man has come to rule and reign? In summary, I believe 2 Thessalonians 2 and Mark 13 are sequentially coherent when one comprehends the rapture as the removal of the restrainer. Please do not fall into anger, condemnation, or doubt if this is not your understanding. I am attempting to harmonize the scriptures, not establish new doctrine or division. May the Spirit of God open our eyes to the light, our ears to the truth, and our heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of Man. Amen.